Good morning, and welcome to everyone joining us on Zoom this morning. Thank you to Reverend Dr. Carolyn Weber for leading us in worship today. We have good news, if you haven't heard it already, the session voted in favor of regathering in the sanctuary on July 4th. Please be on the lookout for more information about that coming soon. We will also be continuing on Zoom for those of you who are not ready to regather just yet. Please join me in our call to worship. All around us, God is looking for folks who will join in serving others. It is as if God is planting seeds of compassion in us, watching for them to bloom in our lives. In our midst, Jesus is walking among us, tending our hearts, watering us with grace. It is as if Jesus is trusting that our souls will grow big enough to welcome everyone. From morning to evening, the Spirit is at work, gently tending this garden called life. It is as if the Spirit has found the perfect spots to bring forth crops of justice and peace. Our opening hymn is the Church's One Foundation.
Thank you.
We long to live as God's people, yet in the very depths of our lives, we know how we have hurt those around us through words and actions, as well as from indifference. But God hears us when we call and answers with the grace we need. Let us pray together as we confess our lives to our God. How you must grieve over us, God of all. You give us blessings to share with others, but we hoard everything for ourselves. You look for us to join you in serving the most vulnerable, but find us worshiping the wealthy and powerful. You offer us joy and wonder to embrace, but we continue to cling to weapons and things. Have mercy on us, anointing God, as you pour your forgiveness into our foolish lives. Plant the seeds of grace, hope, love, and peace in us, so we may blossom and share all these gifts with everyone we meet. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. God's love is not logical and understandable. For God forgives those we never would, and welcomes those we would continue to ignore. This is the one who has mercy on everyone, pouring grace and joy into everyone, including us. Thanks be to God, we are forgiven. Amen. Holy God, we walk by faith and not by sight. So guide our steps in your word today, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we are kept from falling and find our way in your way. Through Christ we pray. Amen.
And now we turn to our gospel reading from Mark chapter 4, verses 26 through 34. Jesus also said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground, and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow, he does not know how. The earth produces of itself, first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle, because the harvest has come." Jesus also said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which when sown upon the ground is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade." With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Amen. We give thanks to God for our gospel lesson this morning. Amen. As I was preparing for this morning's worship, I ran into, this is just so amazing, I could not believe it. I turned my computer on, and the very first thing I looked at was an old sermon of Reverend Dr. Stephen McKinney Whitaker. Many of you will remember him from our presbytery here, as he was a small church pastor in Delavan. And he was also the pastor and co-pastor with Randy Saxon of the United Church in Peoria for several years. And then finally, before he left the presbytery, he was just a very short interim before Ryan Landino was secured for the position of lead presbyter for transformation. And I thought, with the consideration of your congregation here, making another transition into your next stage of pastoral service, that this sermon just really stood out to me so clearly that I believe that it is the word that God really wanted me to bring to you today. And I will just give a little postscript at the end of something that I wanted you to know about that had happened this past week in my own life. Is the harvest going to be big enough? We need to do more, do something, because if we don't have a bumper crop this year, we may have to sell the farm. My Facebook newsfeed, this is Stevens, is constantly filled with articles about how the church can't survive the current decline in worship, why millennials are leaving the church, the rise of the nuns who have no religious affiliation at all, and the church's waning influence. Mixed with these are letters to the dying church. We're afraid the community church is going the way of the family farm, so we better do something. It's not enough to scatter seed. We need to genetically alter the seed so it grows more easily in any kind of soil, so it produces more, so it is hardier and healthier and more resilient. We need a gospel that will grow in today's world, so let's create a hybrid. We need a bit more prosperity to go with this gospel to the poor, a bit more glitz and glam to graft onto this humble gospel. Changing the seed isn't enough, though. We need to change the soil the seed grows in. Let's change the worship. More lights, more entertainment. The gospel can't grow in 1,000-year-old liturgies, after all. We need to till up the worship, break up the unplowed ground of these dusty old sanctuaries. We're afraid we aren't doing enough or aren't doing it well enough. Doing more, though, is usually a sign that you don't trust what you're doing. We don't trust that the seed will grow. We don't trust the power of the gospel to grow itself. The reactionary response is to just throw up our hands and say, okay, God, if you want this kingdom of yours to grow, then you better get to it. And that says, in thinking about, this is a little insertion of mine here, that, well, we've got a welcome sign out in front of the church. The door's open. Everyone is welcome. Well, if you're going to build it, they should come. And that's like having a field of dreams evangelism. If you offer it, they won't necessarily come. Though I think many of us wish that were the case, right? On the other hand, the parable shatters any illusions we have that the fate of the kingdom is in our hands. The church isn't in a young adult novel. We aren't the plucky and likely teen heroes who must rise to some impossible challenge to save the kingdom of God on earth. We are kingdom workers, not kingdom bringers or kingdom savers. We plant the seeds and we prepare for the harvest whenever it suddenly bursts from the earth. But will it be big enough? It seems to get smaller every year. Fewer baptisms, fewer members, fewer pledges. Will it be big enough? The kingdom starts like the smallest seed, a mustard seed. So it's not looking great. How big could it get? Certainly not big enough to fill our sanctuary. Certainly not big enough to meet our budget. Certainly not big enough to put a dent in our city's poverty, moral and financial. What's a small church, a small denomination, a small gospel going to do in a big world? It grows up and it becomes the greatest of all shrubs. That's what it does. A shrub? Really? A shrub? The only people who desire a shrub are the knights who say nigh. We want an orchard of trees. We want a field of flowers. We want a plantation of cash crops, not a shrub, not even the greatest of all shrubs. I think we prefer Ezekiel's cedar in Ezekiel 17, which was another one of our lectionary readings for today. A big, strong tree that houses every kind of bird on the earth. Why can't we have a tree like that? Now that's big enough. We want Ezekiel cedar. We want the tree, not the shrub. We also want forbidden fruit, golden calves, our Father's inheritance, and a Savior who doesn't have to die. So maybe our judgment isn't as great as the greatest of all shrubs. Ezekiel's cedar symbolizes God's restoration of the Davidic kingdom, an earthly kingdom, mighty and proud. But earthly kingdoms rise and fall, and the bigger they are, the weaker they get. Every empire that grows, believing it can become big enough for the whole world, eventually topples like a felled tree. The mustard plant does not rise so high that it may topple and fall. It remains lowly, like a king who enters a city humble and riding on a donkey, who comes not to be served, but to serve, and who humbles himself to take the form of a servant. The kingdom of God is great in its humility and lowness. It stoops to wash feet. It kneels by wounded strangers on the side of the road. It is lifted up, not on the shoulders of servants, but on a cross where all creation is reconciled to God. This lowly shrub is big enough for birds of every kind to find a home. Jew and Gentile, male and female, black and white, gay and straight, rich and poor, introvert and extrovert. Birds of every feather can flock together because of this shrub. This kingdom, this gospel, this God is big enough. The kingdom of God starts off small and grows of itself, independent of our tricks, trends, and tampering. It grows in ways we cannot see and cannot know, until it breaks forth from the ground and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, big enough for people to come from east and west and north and south, from left and right, from uptown and downtown, to sit at the table together. If only all of our churches and hearts were so big. Perhaps at times we think our preaching is in vain. Maybe we believe the soil or the seed has gone bad, so the fields will soon be left fallow. We're afraid our efforts and our talents aren't big enough for the harvest we need. We're right. They aren't. The good news, though, is the harvest isn't dependent on our efforts. The seed grows without us, but the seed still needs to be sown. The mustard plant is an annual. It requires renewed sowing to populate the earth. But the promise of its potential life remains in the power of the seed, not the power of the sower. The harvest is coming, and it will not be of our own making or doing, but we get to bring it in. On that day, we will know just how those seeds we sowed grew in people's hearts, sprouted in communities, and bloomed across the world. We will marvel at all the ways the preaching and hearing of the good news brought hope, peace, joy, and love. We will wonder when it happened, how it happened. But then we'll remember that the kingdom of God is like someone who goes out to sow seed and then sleeps and rises day after day. All the while the seed sprouts and grows. He knows not how. And it could have been a she as well, by the way. And those tiny seeds, tiny like a mustard plant, grow to become the greatest of shrubs, big enough for all the birds of the air to build nests in its shade. We will be amazed, but we won't be surprised. Just a little addition from this past week of mine. In midweek, I received a quick and very urgent text message. A colleague of mine had heard from a colleague of hers over in Zambia, who awoke that morning with excruciating pain in his heart, his chest, and his arms. And he had indicated that all of the doctors, the whole health system in Zambia was striking because they wanted and needed more materials and more pay. And he honestly did not know what to do. And so she texted me quickly. I texted her right back. I said, okay, Jesus is standing there right beside him with his arms open wide, and rays of light and love are just radiating out, and they're covering John, who is this pastor in Zambia. They're covering him right now, and they are flowing through his body. And tell him that what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be working, giving him a healing touch treatment to open up all this, the energy centers in his body, so that the God's great love and light may move through to those places where healing is most needed and where there's compromise of those energy centers. And we know that our God is an awesome God, and God will do it. So we never know how the seeds that have been planted in us, planted in others, planted just about anywhere, will be used by the Holy Spirit in the most miraculous ways. And I did receive a text back from her, and she said he is so grateful for this, and that he is now resting quietly and peacefully. Please pray with me. God of mercy and God of grace, we thank you that you are a God who is big enough to take in our work and to use it, big enough to work while we sleep, big enough for all people to be welcome in your kingdom, big enough to overcome our sin, big enough to use our love. Lord, we thank you, and we look forward to the day when the harvest comes in. Amen.
Thank you.
We give thanks in word and song to God, who makes us glad and gives us joy. Because of all that God has done, we enact our thanksgiving through these tithes and offerings. May God put to good use what we give today. Please join me in the spirit of prayer. Let us remember that these seeds of love, hope, grace, and peace, which we carry in our hearts and souls, as well as our wallets and purses, so that in remembering, we would offer them to our God for use in the work of reconciliation and hope. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please join me in our affirmation of faith. God's sovereign love is a mystery beyond the reach of the human mind. Human thought ascribes to God superlatives of power, wisdom, and goodness. But God reveals divine love in Jesus Christ by showing power in the form of a servant, wisdom in the folly of the cross, and goodness in receiving sinful people. The power of God's love in Christ to transform the world discloses that the Redeemer is the Lord and Creator who made all things to serve the purpose of God's love.
It is now time for us to prepare to receive the sacrament of communion. And so I would invite you, if you need to hunt out something to drink and something to break, whether it's a cracker or whatever it is. And I will just uncover our communion bread here. Friends, behold, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. They will come from north and south and from east and west to sit at table with our Lord God. According to Luke, when our Savior was on the road on the evening of his resurrection, and he was invited to go into the homes of the people in the community of Emmaus, it was in the breaking of the bread that they discovered who he was, because he had given thanks to God and then took the bread and broke it. They had holy heartburn. They said, did not our hearts burn while we were with him on the road together? Let us join together in the great prayer of thanksgiving. May the listening God be with you. May God also be with you. Let us open our hearts to the one who hears us. We offer them to our God, who knows we are all the same. Shout for joy, people of God, and sing glad praises. We join in praising the one who is always with us. Into the emptiness of chaos, you flung the seeds of creation, gardening God. Volcanoes erupted to become gentle lakes. Eye-delighting eagles soared high in the skies. Gentle does and fawns strolled through the mists of morning. All this beauty and goodness was shaped for those created in your image. But we reached out for the weapons of sin and built homes on death's condemned properties. Prophets came to call us back home, yet we persisted in believing that our old ways were the best ways. Determined to no longer grieve over us, you sent Jesus to plant resurrection in our lives. With those who are well known to you and with those we have just met, we sing our joy to you at this time. Night or day, you are holy, God of love, and blessed is your child, Jesus Christ. Walking ancient roads, he would lead us into your kingdom. When we are sleeping, he would give us fresh visions of you. When we arise, he takes us by the hand to show us your wonders, accepting everyone as sisters and brothers. He gave his life so death would lose its power over us. Your resurrection love poured out for all. As we remember his life, ministry, and death, as we celebrate the gifts of his table, we speak of the mystery we call faith. Christ has died so the old creation could begin to pass. Christ is risen, the new creation growing in our midst. Christ will come again, so everyone will be made new. You would pour out your spirit upon the gifts of the bread and the cup, as well as those gathered for this feast. The bread, which is broken, becomes the seeds of hope, planted in despair, of joy, planted in grief, of kindness, planted in cruelty. The cup, which is poured out, becomes the grace which nurtures those who would welcome the forgotten, those who would listen to the voiceless, those who would become justice, so all might find a welcome and home. And when you gather us home from all the far fields we have been planted, we will join with our sisters and brothers around your table of grace and hope, forever shouting our joy to you, God in community, holy in one. Amen. On the night when Jesus was betrayed and arrested, he took the bread, saying, after he had given thanks to God, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Eat this, remembering me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, which is my blood poured for the forgiveness of your sin. All of you drink of it." For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do proclaim the Lord's death and resurrection until Jesus Christ shall come again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Church, in our many places, let us join together in this meal as the body of Christ. And please note, after a short time, I will first hold up the bread, signaling for us to take it together. And after some time passes, I will hold up the cup and we will drink it together. Thank you. And now let us join in prayer with the prayer after communion. Living God, through Jesus Christ, you have fed us with the bread of heaven. Now by your Spirit, send us out to be bread for the world, so that all who receive your grace may never hunger or thirst. We pray this in the name of Jesus, living water and bread of life. Amen. And as we prepare for our time of prayers of the people, I just want you to think about persons who have come across, whether it's your prayer thoughts or whether it is across your actual physical path from this past week, individuals in your families or extended families and communities whom you know have particular needs on this day. And we'll just hold those up for God, each and every one of us. We don't even need to name them because our Lord knows them already. And so let us pray our prayers of the people. God of all nations, we thank you for moving all history toward your good purposes and plans. We pray for oppression to come to an end and for injustice to cease, so that people everywhere may live in peace and dignity. We pray for all those who sit in the seats of power to learn your ways of mercy and kindness. Here in this community, teach us to work together for the common good, caring for our neighbors and growing in understanding of what challenges they face. Gracious God, we know that you are at work in the things that are unseen, coming among us in uncommon and often unnoticed ways. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear how and where you are moving and changing all things. Help us to look for your kingdom in the ways of children and others who are vulnerable among us, to seek you at the margins among those overlooked or ostracized. Humble us, so that we can learn from those who are meek in all the earth. Life-giving God, for anyone living with depression, chronic pain, or long-term illness, we ask for your healing and tender care. For those who have lost employment or the opportunity to be engaged with others in meaningful service, we pray for new opportunities to spring up. Finally, dear seed planter God, no matter how small our faith is, we pray that you will give us good growth in our discipleship to you, so that we may be faithful ambassadors of Christ, sharing his love and working for the reconciliation of the world. We pray this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen. Thank you. The God who has reconciled us to one another as well as the holy community sends us forth. We will go to gather the broken as we bring healing in our hands. Jesus, who has shaped us into new people with his grace-filled hands, sends us forth. We will go to welcome those we have ignored, drawing the stranger into a warm embrace. The Spirit, who teaches us how to look at others with the eyes of love and hope, sends us forth. We will go to become one with those tossed aside, to be the community of hope for which they have searched. And now may the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the continuing communion of our sisterhood and brotherhood be with us always. Amen.